We're pleased to have as one of the presenters at this year's Sperry Symposium, Brother Marcus Helvacio Martins, a native of Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. Brother Martins joined the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints in July 1972. According to the Church News of August 1978, Brother Martins became the first black member to serve as a full-time missionary for the Church in the 20th century. His other church service includes stints as a bishop, member of several state high councils, and many other priesthood leadership positions. He was also a temple officiator and one of the translators of the Book of Mormon into the Portuguese language. Brother Martins holds a PhD in sociology, a master's degree in organizational behavior, and bachelor's degree in business management. He has taught religion and sociology at Brigham Young University in Provo, Ricks College, and currently is an associate professor of religion at BYU-Hawaii. Several of his papers and lectures can be found on the internet site in BYU, on the internet at BYU-Hawaii's site. Brother and Sister Miriam Martins are the parents of four children. Brother Martins.
I appreciate the opportunity to be with you in this symposium and to share some insights about the growth of the church. And we have heard many fine presenters reminding us of the growth of the church in the 20th century, the miraculous events that have led to this growth. And they have also reminded us of the truly universal character of the church as we see its membership rates increase literally all over the world. In fact, in many places that were closed to the church just two decades ago. But now as we begin a new century, it's almost unavoidable that we start to think about what lies ahead. And I confess that I have had a personal interest in this. And for the last 5 years or so, I have dedicated some of my time to conceive some possible perspectives for the church in the 21st century. I have also to tell you that I do so without any claim to inspiration or authority on the subject. The prophet Joseph Smith once stated that it is the privilege of every elder to speak of the things of God. So what I'm doing here is essentially use that privilege and share with you some of the thoughts that I have had. And even though I will be quoting scriptures and church presidents in this presentation, I am solely responsible for the analysis and the inferences you are about to hear. Now, Elder Marlin K. Jensen, in his presentation in this symposium, reminded us that back in 1984, sociologist Rodney Stark suggested to the academic community that there might be as many as 265 million Latter-day Saints worldwide by the year 2080. That was his high projection. His low projection was about 60 million. His high projection, 265 million. Instead of discussing the problems inherent to straight-line statistical projections, if we would, at least tentatively, if we would accept Stark's projection as a potential goal, with just about 80 years ahead of us, we would be forced to ask, where and how would we find, teach, baptize, hopefully retain these additional 254 million Latter-day Saints? In recent years, the church has been baptizing about 300,000 new converts annually. Considering that many among the future members will be offspring of the present and future converts, achieving that 265 million mark would still require over 1 million baptisms annually, beginning right away. When we consider the Lord's mandate to his church, the numbers become even more overwhelming. In the scriptures, we find statements like the following: go ye into all the world, preach the gospel to every creature, acting in the authority which I have given you, baptizing in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Now, the current worldwide population amounts to about 6 billion people. That's the current estimate. If we manage to baptize 1 million individuals every year, it would take us almost 6,000 years to baptize a number equivalent to the current world population, not to mention the future population. Now, while it is true that the Lord commanded us to preach the gospel to every creature, we are supposed to baptize only those who believe. But still, the numbers clearly show that the task ahead of us is nothing short of monumental. And one of the obstacles to the church's mission of preaching the gospel to every creature is the fact that the population of the world is spread over vast distances. At the end of the 20th century, about 45% of the world population lived in urban areas. Reports from the United Nations state that in 1996, there were close to 2.7 billion persons living in urban areas. Of those, about 800 million, or about one-third, lived one-third of the total urban population lived in 338 cities and metropolitan areas with populations around or above 1 million. And about 880 million, roughly another third of the total urban population, lived in 3,015 cities with populations around or above 100,000 persons. The remaining 977 million lived in small cities with 2,500 or more individuals. That still leaves aside the rural population, a number close to 3.2 billion persons who represent about 54% of the world population in 1996, most of them located in faraway places without the minimal numbers to staff and sustain stable church units. So then the next logical question must be, how can the church accomplish the formidable task of reaching, teaching, baptizing, and later nurturing large populations spread over large distances? Now, in 1974, President Spencer W. Kimball stated the following: "I have faith that the Lord will open doors when we have done everything in our power. I believe that the Lord is anxious to put into our hands inventions of which we laymen have hardly had a glimpse." This statement left a strong and permanent impression in my mind since I read it for the first time. And now we have come a long way, at least technologically speaking, we have come a long way since 1974. Today we enjoy technology far beyond our imagination 26 years ago. We have portable computers powered by ultra-fast processors. We have time-saving utilities like word processors, spreadsheets, databases, electronic mailing. Computer utilities also for information gathering and publishing, and laser-based data storage and transmission, digital telephone networks, cable and satellite television, etc. And we not only enjoy these technological marvels, but we have also seen in the 20th century a phenomenon that appears to have been unique to that century, which is the mass production and subsequent popularization of cutting-edge technologies, even in developing countries. But having considered these factors, we must ask, or at least we must not assume, that we have reached the pinnacle of technological advancement. In fact, when we consider current trends and possibilities for the not-so-distant future, we may conclude that we are on the threshold of technological breakthroughs that will have as great an impact in our lives and in furthering the mission of the church as radio, telephone, television, and the automobile had in the lives of the people of the 20th century. So I have conceived a few visions, or almost dreams, for the use of a few of the currently emerging technologies in a not so distant future, possibly within the next 50 years. All things remaining constant as they are now. Although a thorough discussion of the economic feasibility or the present technical obstacles are beyond the scope of my presentation today, I hope this can still be the beginning of a fruitful interaction and discussion of wonderful possibilities ahead of us. So, among other things, I imagine the advent of, number one, home-based missionaries, two, virtual branches, and three, a far expanded temple work. Now, about the first one, home-based missionaries. In his preface to the Doctrine and Covenants, the Lord stated that there would be no obstacles to his servants in their mission to raise the voice of warning to the nations. Since one of the challenges to be overcome is distance, I would envision the advent of part-time missionaries who might teach the gospel out of their own homes using a communication device that would by itself succeed present-day televisions, computers, and telephones. With such a device, we could have literally millions of part-time home missionaries. And these would be regular members of the church in good standing who would be assigned to knock on people's satellite dishes and present an introductory virtual reality discussion about the restored gospel. Back in 1970, then Elder Spencer W. Kimball of the 12 suggested that we would use these inventions to, quote, awaken interest and acquaint people of the world with the truths, to ease their prejudices and give them a general knowledge. We shall need to answer specific questions, and perhaps that can be done, notice this, perhaps that can be done by two-way radio and TV, perfected to a point beyond our present imagination. You gotta love prophecy. You gotta love prophets. You know, here we are talking about these things, and they have, you know, here's a prophet who considered this 30 years ago. President Kimball continued, it is conceivable that such a program, greatly perfected, could be multiplied 10,000 times in 10,000 tongues and dialects in 10,000 places far and near. Tens of thousands of young missionaries endowed with the power from on high will follow up the proselyting. Now, the second idea that I propose, or the second vision of the future, is virtual branches. Using much refined three-dimensional virtual reality communication media, people in faraway lands might one day be able to meet for church services without leaving their homes. They would see, hear, feel, and interact as if they were in an actual meeting house. Despite the continuous migratory flow towards urban areas, current projections state that by the year 2030, a significant percentage of the world population will still be living in sparsely populated areas, where the construction of permanent meeting houses might not be feasible. Advanced communication devices could be the only way by which these future LDS populations might be reached and nourished. For some, the idea, this idea might appear, you know, inadmissible, maybe even weird or crazy. However, one must remember some of the main objectives of our church meetings, or at least the Sunday meetings specifically. Number one, to worship the Lord. Number two, to instruct and edify one another through the ministry of the Word of God by the power of the Holy Ghost. Under this light, the idea of attending a virtual meeting might not be so absurd after all. Ordinances like the sacrament could be performed partially live and partially electronically. Each individual or family would have to provide bread and water for themselves. And after the sacrament hymn, a priest, perhaps thousands of miles away, would offer the sacramental prayers in the appropriate manner. And each individual or family would in turn partake of the bread and water. Sunday school lessons could be provided by the members themselves, who would have callings in these virtual branches, just like callings in the physical branches. Technology would not take center stage, nor substitute teachers. It would just be the means of extending the capabilities of the church human resources. Now, as far as an expanded temple work, if we imagine then in the future, we could have one temple in each major city of the world. Let's say cities with population of 100,000 or more. We could easily imagine the existence of about 3,000 temples throughout the world. Advanced and ultra-fast means of transportation, the successors of our present-day trains, buses, and automobiles, perhaps powered by magnetic levitation or other anti-gravity technology, would allow temple patrons to reach a temple 500 or more miles away in a trip of possibly no more than 1 or 2 hours. While in missionary work we are required to baptize only the believers, in temple work, we perform ordinances for all deceased persons above the age of accountability. That translates not only in billions of ordinances, but also into gigantic databases necessary to coordinate the work in all the world. Thus, the existence of thousands of temples in the future make perfect sense. And emerging technology in optical-based data storage also bring us hope of fast and easily accessible worldwide databases, easily accessible worldwide databases of genealogical data and temple ordinance records. We may also consider, those of us who were present at these sessions in the year 2000, we might also consider the dedication of the Palmyra, New York Temple as another shadow of things to come, or a prototype for things to come. If anything, that broadcast showed the feasibility of closing our stake centers one night a week to conduct endowment sessions conveyed through the church satellite system, and probably using some form of secured transmission. Now, after considering these exciting possibilities, and once again, these are just dreams, and as I said in the beginning, I don't claim any authority, I don't claim any inspiration for it, but after considering these possibilities, one must return to the reality of the present and consider the plausibility of such vision. Besides the previously mentioned technical hurdles, we might also list as possible additional impediments to the fulfillment of this vision. Number one, the fluctuations in the highly volatile global financial markets. And two, what I call micro wars or regional skirmishes within a single nation or between neighboring nations. From a purely secular standpoint, one could just say that, well, major adjustments would be needed in order for the global financial and political systems to allow these visions of the future to take place. And that would be the end of the discussion. However, since we are dealing with a divine mandate to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ, we have to add unshakable faith to our study and explore our vision further. The Prophet Joseph Smith explained, quote, "The whole visible creation as it now exists is the effect of faith," end of quote. Since that is so, why not accept that our work in building the kingdom of God must also be the result of faith? With that thought in mind, an additional step in our preparation as a church and people might be a better understanding of the spiritual tools we have available to us to do the work. We may be blessed in using these miraculous gifts in a much larger scale abroad after we have familiarized ourselves with their use in our own neighborhoods. Now, it so happens that when we use terms such as the whole world or the mission field, one may fall into the trap of thinking that these terms refer only to far and exotic places in foreign lands. In reality, one must never lose sight of the fact that Utah, Southeast Idaho, or any other area with a large LDS presence are an integral part of the whole world. And that the term mission field, that has become a common expression in the LDS discourse, usually used to signify faraway lands, could have an alternative definition, which I propose as follows. The mission field is any place on earth where the threefold mission of the church is being implemented. In other words, the mission field is any place where there is a single soul yet to be baptized, or any place where there is a single soul yet to be brought back into full fellowship or full activity in the Church of Jesus Christ, or any place where there is a single soul yet to receive his or her own endowments in the house of the Lord. With this broader perspective in mind comes the realization that one's place of residence is where miracles should be expected to happen, and not only in some exotic, far-off place. It is quite possible to fail to notice the occurrence of miracles around us because we often expect them to happen somewhere else. The Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints will always move forward under inspired leadership. And Latter-day Saints in good standing cannot afford the luxury of falling under spiritual lethargy or apathy. If we expect nothing spiritually new in our homes and neighborhoods, how can we expect to render miraculous service in Russia or China or Nigeria? If our individual religiosity is not on fire in our own homes and neighborhoods, how do we expect to kindle it in others abroad? The time to move forward at an unprecedented rate, despite everything that has happened in the 20th century, the time to move forward at a yet unprecedented rate seems to have arrived. In the future, church history scholars and members in general will certainly acknowledge the key role President Gordon B. Hinckley will have had in initiating and consolidating this push forward that will lead to the church and will change the face of the church forever. Looking at his inspired leadership so far, we see ample evidence of a changing pace. And the fact that tomorrow, the 100th temple will be dedicated in Boston, Massachusetts, I think it is one of these evidences. The future for those who strive to live righteously and serve the Lord is majestic, full of marvelous spiritual and temporal blessings, and meaningful callings and assignments. In the future, these callings and assignments will very likely involve teaching and nurturing millions of church members and non-members in all parts of the world. The following words from President Kimball seem to challenge us to look for the future with faith and courage. And he said, quote, "The problems of the world cannot possibly be solved by skeptics or cynics whose horizons are limited by the obvious realities. We need men, and we might add women also, who can dream of things that never were and ask, why not? We do not worry about how and when and why. We say, why not? I repeat my witness that the Lord will unlock doors and his promises may be relied upon. I know he will stay the opposition. He will mellow hearts and he will pave the way if we have faith to pursue." End of quote. And President Gordon B. Hinckley seemed to have added his own witness to this wonderful view of the future when he said, quote, "If we will go forward, never losing sight of our goal, speaking ill of no one, leaving the great principles we know to be true, this cause will roll on in majesty and power to fill the earth. Doors now closed to the preaching of the gospel will be opened. I see a wonderful future in a very uncertain world. If we will cling to our values, if we will build on our inheritance, if we will walk in obedience before the Lord, if we will simply live the gospel, we will be blessed in a magnificent and wonderful way. Great has been our past, wonderful is our present, glorious can be our future." End of quote. And I want to add my own witness of the truthfulness of these prophetic statements and of the marvelous opportunities that lie ahead of us. And I do so in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you. The history of the LDS Church is marked by its expansion across the globe. Latter-day prophets have focused on building temples, flooding the earth with the Book of Mormon, and strengthening the saints in all parts of the world. Join us for presentations from church leaders, historians, and gospel scholars as they focus on the past and future of the LDS Church. The Sidney B. Sperry Symposium, Out of Obscurity, the Church in the 20th Century.